Virginia Dad. How about it? That was State Street we just passed right there. We're in Bristol right now. And we are headed to Clear Creek Golf Course to try to knock off another state on the Birdie Tour. See if we can do it. What's up, everybody? It's Buffalo Ben 15 Golf back at it again. We are at Clear Creek Golf Club out in Bristol, Virginia. What a nice day for golf, huh? 68 degrees right now. And today, playing the back tees. 63-14, 71.7 rating, 133 slope. Par for the course is 71. Goal today is to try and make a birdie. That's literally the only goal. If I shoot 90 but still do that, I won't complain. Because this is all about Birdie Tour, guys.
Started. Yeah, started. Go ahead.
We're good.
You going?
Yep.
Okay.
All right, guys. Exciting one today, as Rick Shields likes to say. My goodness, guys. Here we are. Clear Creek Golf Club in Bristol, Virginia, home state of the legendary Sam Snead.
Way left.
I don't know if he's ever played this course before. He's from a town called Ashwood, which is about a two-hour drive from Bristol on the western side of the state. But if anybody in the comments has any knowledge of that, please let me know, because it'd be pretty cool to know that I played a course that Sam Snead also played at some point in his life. Tiger hasn't got him just yet. For now, he sits as a co-owner of the throne of most ever PGA wins. Oh my gosh, guys. Just an absolutely beautiful golf course that really did deserve that intro walking up there. It does not have that much notoriety as many of the other ones in this area, such as Sevierville Golf Club and Gatlinburg Golf Club. But let me tell you guys, this course can give those two a run for its money. It really is that nice of a golf course. I paid $38 with a cart for 18 holes. And it's a pretty nice golf course. A pretty nice first hole as well. Feeling good, guys. Feeling good. Oh, my gosh. I am so pumped to be here. Clear Creek Golf Club, Bristol, Virginia. The Twin Cities, Bristol, Tennessee, on the other side of State Street. 71.7 rating, 133 slope. So this course has some teeth. And I'm going to experience some of it.
It's out.
As I go out of bounds, and effectively, that's a two-shot penalty right there. So, the good old three off the tee, no one ever likes to see it, not a good look. Even though you pipe it right down the middle. Oh my gosh. You remember when that guy from Heather Hills niced my putt? Yeah, well, Dad niced my drive. Right there. So
a little chunky.
About 9,500 yards in for maybe more like 110 actually, because I hit that almost 90 yards into this green that's pretty thin from left to right. I'll tell you what though, guys, this course isn't very long, but it's like set up on like a man-made lake, a big old reservoir. Well, as I was so rudely interrupted, he scores with that great chip shot. That was absolutely flawless chip shot to at least minimize the damage there. And Dad also hits a really good one. Double wedge worthy, back-to-back episodes. But as I was saying before,
love-hate relationship.
The whole course is kind of based around this big old man-made reservoir in the middle of it. And like all the holes, you kind of go all the way around the lake, slowly but surely. And it's very sloped in order to get down to that lake, because it used to be a river before it got dammed up. And so a lot of these holes, one side of it is going to be nothing but death over by the lake. And the other side is going to be nothing but death in the rocky forests and just jungle of the mountains. So it's very difficult golf course for how short it is. I thought for sure when I saw that yardage, this course would be pretty manageable. But as you can see so far, I've not done the greatest. As you can see, this is one of those holes that has a ton of elevation change due to those mountains. And, yeah, I mean, just look at how far below my feet this ball is. Absolutely ridiculous. And stepping up to it here, just after two pretty bad wedge shots to start, I teethed one on one and then I chunked one on the second one. This is by far the best of the three, even though it's not that great, which is goes to show how poorly I'm hitting them this morning. I'm not one to make excuses, but I did drive a little bit over an hour to get here from where we were staying at Watauga Lake in Butler, Tennessee. And oh my gosh, guys, what a great trip. What a great trip. I was so glad to be able to head down to that area and have a chance to knock off another state on the Birdie Tour. We've got seven so far. We have Michigan, Ohio, Indiana, Florida, Kentucky, or no, not Kentucky. We have Michigan, Ohio, Indiana, Tennessee, North Carolina, Florida, Alabama so far. So,
thing I like about this course.
Hopefully we can add Virginia to that list and make it eight.
Gotta keep this one straight.
My goal this year is to be double digits by the end of the year. I'm going to plan on going out to Wisconsin in August, I think. Like early-ish August. I'm planning on making a trip out there. So I'm going to try to head to kind of the Wisconsin Dells area. I know there's a really good course there called Trapper's Turn. That is one of the top-rated public courses in the state.
I know, and it was still.
And so that'd be number nine. And on the way back, I would conceivably able to stop somewhere in the outskirts of Chicago, Illinois, and play somewhere there.
Channel my inner Tommy Ganey baseball swing.
But boy, oh boy, would that be quite an accomplishment to get all of those states by the end of the year. I'm looking at my map right now. I'm like really close to being able to go all the way around Lake Michigan and really close to getting all the way to the Atlantic Ocean.
Oh my gosh.
I look back at like commitments like this that I made that were kind of half-hearted commitments back when I got this idea, and now I'm realizing how far it's come in such a short amount of time. And it's really just, it's every time I get one of them birdies, it's like a weight has been lifted off my shoulders that I can't really explain. I know it's like only one hole, but the fact is, it's like it's 50 holes, and each time you complete one, it's like legs of a marathon. Each time you get past one, you feel really good about yourself, and that motivates you to keep going to finish the next one. So hopefully we can find some motivation to not take four to get down 40 yards from the flag. Okay, Cody Jackson. Dang it. That was a good spot,
to get down 40 yards from the flag.
Oh, boy. Gotta stop doing that after drives like that. You saw how great that four iron was down the left side. To be fair, it's the tightest hole on the course, and there's really not much I could do to keep it from rolling off the side a little bit with the spin that I put on it. I hit the exact shot that I wanted to hit, a chaser draw to kind of get down there as far as I could, and I got pretty close. But this one's going to be chasing pretty far, guys. I love it. I love when I absolutely crank it. And it's a par 5 as well. Golden opportunity here as we only have 212 in. I'm using 5 iron because it's downhill a little bit. And also there's a drop-off off the left side that's OB over there. And as you can see, I aim quite a bit to the right. I think the green goes all the way back there.
It actually went in this.
But I was wrong. I was wrong. And we're taking a drop. Oh my gosh. What is that? 2 penalties so far, effectively 3 with the out of bounds. You know, I've been watching Itchin' to Scratch Golf lately. The guy from the Cleveland area that I've told you about. His channel is actually growing like a weed right now. Good for him. He's almost at 200 subscribers. Last year he was at like 50 at the end of the year. He's really blowing up. I'll get my turn, guys. Don't worry. But I've been watching a lot of him, and one of his goals in order to get to a 3 handicap, he said this year, is his goal. And he says one of the ways he's going to do it is have 1 penalty ball or less per 9, and I've already broken that one. Granted, it's a new course. I drove an hour to get here. I'm not one to make excuses, guys. I don't like doing that because it's like no one cares. You all play the same course. It doesn't matter where you're from. It doesn't matter what your game looks like. It doesn't matter what your strengths are, what your weaknesses are. You play the same course as everyone else. And sometimes that course can absolutely beat the doors off of you. It's just not been a good round so far, for sure. Just kind of frustrating bogey after frustrating bogey. And as you can see, me kind of going for a pin that I probably have no business going for. And that's what happens. You put a ball in the creek when you're feeling good. When you're feeling like, ooh, I got a pin right there. I'm going to go get it. Sounds good, but it's not. Sounds good, but that strategy is not the strategy, let me tell you that. Oh my gosh. So stepping up to a very important putt here. This is to only drop 1 shot to get to 6 over, which means I need to par out for a 42. It's not looking good.
Another drop shot.
It's really not.
It's almost a historic collapse right here, in case you didn't figure it out.
I thought when I hit that putt it was going to go in. I thought I hit it well. I thought I did what I wanted to do with it.
Over through 6. Ouch.
Yeah, I need.
And as you can see, I am starting to get very, very frustrated. And with that being said,
jeez. Have you ever sneezed mid-swing?
It's just
no, I would.
A lot of things are falling apart right now.
That happens, right?
As I sneeze in my practice routine. Comment below if you've ever sneezed in the middle of your swing. I bet it's so bad. I bet it's so horrible. But this round right now, I'm just trying to avoid it from getting horrible. It's just 7 over through 6. Got the hardest hole on the course coming up. Thank goodness. I pull a drive out of my butt, and it stays alive on a very tight hole. It's just... kick off that side of the mountain over there, and it works out. It works out. It is very thick rough in here, though. As you can see, I go back to my bag to grab an extra club after I take a second look at those wetlands. I can't lie. I was playing this like it was 30 yards longer than it was. Very difficult shot here over the wetlands. Got a green that slopes. Kind of a turtle back away from you at the end. This is one of the best shots I've hit all year. I swear to you. This was a 1 out of 20 at least shot. Possibly 1 out of 50 or so. I could stand there with 20 balls and probably only get one other one as close as that one. That was a spectacular golf shot. It landed right on the front edge of the fringe, just over those wetlands, hopped up onto that top tier, as you see, and got a very manageable putt here for birdie. This is only about 15, 16 feet, so I'm really going to give this a go. How did that not keep going? Oh my gosh, playing 2 p.m. greens at 11 a.m. Because we started at around, I think it was actually 8:30 when we started, so this was probably closer to 10 o'clock, a little after 10 at this point. So, yeah, as you can see, grass is still pretty frosty. So, trying to shake off the frost here as we head into the signature hole.
That's going right
Peninsula
at it.
Par right 3 overlooking right. The big lake.
Oh, yeah. Oh, just
that this course yeah, just is famous for. Yeah. And yeah, I hit a very edge. Good tee shot.
I mean, look at this.
Yeah, as boom. We take a
it's
spectacular
amazing.
Drive.
We up. Paid $38 for all of this. They're just giving this away. And we're on the green. Life is good. Life is good.
Isn't it?
Life will be good after I get this birdie and knock another state off the birdie tour. Another kind of mid-range putt here. This time right to left, uphill a little bit, and just overread it a little bit. Very close, but very happy with a 3 on this hole. Back-to-back pars on 2 very difficult holes. Exactly what we needed to steady the ship a little bit.
This hole is amazing.
And as you can see, I'm starting to get a little bit more cheery, a little more pep in my step as I head into a hole where I'm going to need to pepper it a few times for sure. Longest hole on the course, 565, par 5, water all the way down the right. Oh, man, just no easy tee shots on this course, guys. If you want to test your driver game, come out to Clear Creek. It is a tough test of accuracy golf. It's not a super gimmicky course, but you have to be ready to
get into the
hit
short
different
grass.
Kinds of shots for sure.
Short of it.
Mm-hmm. Most every hole, you can see what's going on. There's only like a couple holes towards the end where it gets blind a little bit. 16 and 17 particularly are two big dogleg par fours. One of them super downhill, as you guys are going to see on the back nine. Also, guys, I'm sorry I've lost my last couple back nines. My phone has not been acting properly lately with storage. I'm just gradually accruing storage for whatever reason, even though I put all these movies on my computer, on my YouTube, and flush out all the stuff it takes to make it on my phone. For whatever reason, it just hasn't all been flushing out, it seems. And it's led to me having to do some stuff I don't want to have to do. But I'll tell you what I do want to do. Get up and down. That's right. Three straight cars to end the nine. That is a spectacular ending to the front nine. Exactly what we needed. Kind of steady the ship a little bit. Yeah, as you can see, 1, 11, and 5. The handicaps for those three holes. And for being a par 3, 11's usually a pretty tough rating. But we pulled it off. We brought it back a little bit. It was a very hard-fought 9 that was full of more pain than I had bargained for. As you can see, the fairways were not great. The greens in regulation were not great. The penalties, 3 penalty strokes. I'll tell you what, 3 penalty strokes hitting only 2 of 9 greens and I shoot a 43. That's pretty good scrambling. That's pretty respectable for sure. Oh my gosh, guys. What a place. I mean, the last thing you want to do on these kind of vacation rounds, because you look forward to it for so long, you know it's coming, you know that you're looking forward to it. The last thing you want to do is go out there and shoot a stinker, and then you're kicking yourself, and you're like, why did I waste all that time thinking about it? Why did I waste all that time hyping it up? Because it didn't work out. Really, you got to kind of put yourself in a different mindset than that. And that's something that I'm learning how to do still as well. It's something that I know a lot of people my skill level are known for, kind of overthinking these sorts of rounds, kind of thinking of them as a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to shoot the round of your life, you know? Speaking of which, 2 calendar years ago exactly today, July 8th, 2020, I broke 80 for the first time at Farmington Hills. It won't, I mean, it was this Wednesday of July, but not officially 2 years yet, 2 full calendar years, I will say, though. And boy, oh boy, guys, what a day that was. What a day this could still be. Who knows? The back nine could be so much better. We got 3 straight pars heading into it. Pick up right where we left off. You never know what can happen, guys. Back to par 35 as well. We could still pull this off. It was a great turnaround to a 9 that could have easily gotten away from me. But I hit the good shots when I needed to. That's kind of the name of the game sometimes. Sometimes you don't need to hit every shot good. You just need to hit them good when the course demands you to. And even on courses like this, it's not every hole. So with that being said, guys, I'm really looking forward to the back nine. I promise it will go out this time. And by the way, I shot a 38 on the back nine at Pine Trace for an 8 over 80. It was a good round. Nate shot a 75 as well. We both had good days. Got a chance. We still got a chance. Got to stay positive, guys. Here we go. All right. Fingers crossed. Let's see what happens. This is Buffalo Ben, 15, signing off. Have a good day, everyone.